great it is, how great it is. Wow, 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 wow. How great it is to be here with you, the viewer. And we honor one another because this content is very clear. It's very simple. We present it not in a progressive way, but in a 360-degree way. I never know what I'm going to bounce to next. It's all in flow, spontaneous flow. And especially those who are actually considering or doing the WOW practice, which is the most difficult will to find in this world, to accept that one insight settles it all. This is true. One insight settles it all. The ego loves all the spirituality in the world, all the books. In fact, that's the ego. That's egoic mind. What is egoic mind? Mind evaluating itself is egoic mind. Now, in the East, they have different nomenclature. They call what we call the mind, they call it the self. And what we call egoic mind, they call the mind. So there's a lot of confusion there in nomenclature. But neither one is wrong. It's just different labels. We're talking about the exact same thing, of course. But if we want to try to one-up one another, we'll say, oh, well, you don't understand. You think, you know, this. That's ridiculous. It's just different nomenclature. We call mind, capital M, you know, mind, our spirit, mind, what is what in the East they will call the self. Self, Ram Maharshi calls it the self. We call it the mind because this includes creativity. And the mind is, you know, infinitely creative. So, and then mind evaluating itself, trying to evaluate itself, is what we would call egoic mind, what they would call maya, samsara, delusion, sin, false mind, false self, all that kind of stuff. It's mind evaluating itself, or trying to evaluate itself. Now, the mind that's trying to evaluate itself loves spirituality. It loves spirituality. Spirituality is what it lives on. Because spirituality is makes it seem like it's trying to get better. It's really trying to find the right evaluation, okay? But all of this is a defense system. It's an avoidance tactic to avoid the practice of flattening all evaluation, which is the WOW practice, the Dharma King WOW practice. It's all an avoidance of that. And you can go on, we can go on, mind trying to evaluate itself can go on for eons and eons and eons with all this spirituality and not get anywhere. I would just still be utterly stuck in the mud. Doesn't do anything. It's just, it's avoidance. It's avoidance. Padmasambhava said, one insight settles it all. I experienced this and I said, oh my gosh, it's so easy. It's so incredibly easy. I said, why aren't we doing this? What is going on? So this has really deepened my understanding of what's going on here. And it's very simple. Mind, which is what we, in Christianity, we call Son of God, which God, the Prime Creator, God, the expression of the Prime Creator, is the Son of God, and then God, the Holy Spirit, is this blessing of God the Son, because God the Son tried to be greater than God the Father, the Prime Creator. So God the Son had this idea of being greater than God, creating a new creation, saying, I'm the Prime Creator of this new creation, and it's separate from God. And in order to do this, mind hallucinated the absence of reality, of God, which is all value everywhere always. God is all value everywhere always. So mind, which is what we really are, hallucinated the absence of reality. Very simple. That's how the trouble that we're struggling with here came from that. And then hallucination is totally unstable because the mind can just stop hallucinating any instant. And mind said, gee, that's not much of a creation I got going here, huh? Hallucination doesn't seem like a very stable creation at all. So it tried to stabilize this imaginary, hoped for new creation through what's called doubt. Through doubt. And doubt says, ah, I don't know, maybe it's this, maybe I can stabilize it, maybe I can't. But it's up in the air, you know, it's not definitive. It's not definitive, there's nothing definitive here. And then out of doubt came hope and fear, hope and fear. And hope and fear, the interaction of hope and fear is what we call, egoic mind, our mind evaluating itself, or the ocean of samsara, is thinking, thoughts, concepts. Thinking, thought, and concepts came from hope and fear, the play of hope and fear, duality. Oh, I hope I can fixate it, but I fear that I can't. But I hope I can't, I fear that I can't. You see, like that. But first doubt says, well, I'm not sure. I'm not sure if I can. Instead of just saying, oh, I can't. It's a fact, obviously I cannot. Mind is free. So that's the etiology of our situation. And we're walking it back and trying to say, how do we get free of this? This is difficult. Well, when we hallucinate the absence of God, then doubt gives rise to hope and fear, which gives rise to thinking. What we engage ourselves with is what's called seeking value. We are seeking value in trying to create a new creation. We say, oh, it's a new creation. There's disproportionate value everywhere. I mean, this looks valuable. That looks valuable over there more than what's valuable here. Or this right here seems more valuable than over there. But then there's a third option over here, and it's constantly shifting and changing values. That's the play of hope and fear. We hope we can find value in the new creation where value is disproportionate. You see, if value, all value were everywhere always, it would be reality. So we're hallucinating the absence of all value everywhere always, and yet we still are craving value. So we see value, but it's disproportionate value everywhere. We're perceiving, oh, there's disproportionate value everywhere. It's just made up, really. But this is how we imagine that we have a new creation. Now we've become extremely addicted to this activity of seeking, you know, disproportionate value and the action of seeking, evaluating. We're constantly evaluating. How's our progress here? How's the new creation coming? Well, I'm sorting out all this value, and I'm discarding the stuff that isn't valuable and hoarding the stuff that is valuable. This is the activity of delusion, okay? We're so addicted to this that when we are willing to accept that hallucination cannot be stabilized at all, and we say, okay, enough of that. Let's accept reality's still real, and we get a glimpse of it, this. We have a little bit of willingness, and we experience all value everywhere always. And we say, oh, that's perfect. That's what I really want. That's perfect. Everything's just perfect like this. Wow. And then we start saying, okay, but I got this nagging feeling like I need to do something, and that nagging feeling that I need to do something is we feel we need to evaluate. But then we say, wait a minute, how in the heck can I evaluate this? All value everywhere always. There's no way to evaluate value. Okay, it's everywhere. All value is everywhere always. There's impossible to evaluate this. You see, impossible. And then you start getting jittery. You say, but I'm used to this. I can't live without it. I can't live without evaluating. And so we start trying to evaluate reality again. And then we lose sight of it. It's like, oh, it's gone. What happened? I was trying to evaluate and it disappeared on me. That's what happens, right? So, this is the trouble. Why we cannot just simply, easily accept reality is real, and that's the end of it. All value ever, we're always perfect. Why can't we just accept this? Because we keep trying to evaluate this. That's the only problem we really have. And the fear of a lack of ability to evaluate, that continuity fear is like, wait a minute, I'm going from the habit of evaluating to seeing there's nothing to evaluate. Oh my gosh, I feel like I'm in an abyss, you know, I've gone to an abyss or something. That's the only problem we have. We don't have any other problem. No other problem than that. So that simplifies the spirituality, doesn't it? I mean, do we need all these books? No, we don't, actually. And then to cure this one problem that we have, all we need to do is get familiar with flattening evaluation out, just flattening all evaluation out. And that's the WOW practice. And that's very, very simple. And that's what we do here. And what this does is gets us used to progressively get more and more familiar with one evaluation settles it all. One evaluation settles it all. Let me just settle on one evaluation and no other. For the entire play of thinking and concepts and hope and fear. All of that. All my hopes and all my fears. Oh, I hope that Sri Sri Anandamayi will bless me. Wow. Oh, I really fear that she won't bless me. Wow. Exact same response. Exact same evaluation for everything that arises in your mind. So this morning I was doing this practice and I came up with so many, many, many different angles of hope and fear, right? Oh, I hope something really good's going to happen. I fear that, you know, something good won't happen. And you apply wow to everything that arises like that. So that's how I started my day. Just wow, 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 wow. Just amazing practice. This is the only practice we need to do. This is the only practice we need to do. That's it. One problem and one practice to solve it. And that's the sum total of anything we need to know. We don't need to know anything other than that. So I don't feel like I need any books at all, or any teachings, and all the spirituality. I don't need it at all. I can go play golf. I know exactly what the problem is, and exactly what to do about it. Which is great. It saves a lot of time, doesn't it? Good luck wading through the hundreds and hundreds and hundreds of thousands of treaties of Tibetan Buddhism or Buddhism and all the, you know, commentaries of this Christianity and this religion and on and on and on and on and on and on. You don't have to do any of that. You don't have to do any of that. But who is it that is able to see this and without hope and fear, you're like, oh my God, I think I might need these. Well, here, I don't feel like I need them at all. Now, I have a couple books around. I didn't used to have any, but I have a couple. But I don't need to go to them so much anymore because I'm able to practice. So practice really frees you from all spirituality. It frees you. You don't have to keep seeking in spirituality for the answer at all. But getting to this is so difficult because I saw one insight sells it all. I experienced it. I said, well, why don't we all do this? And I realized other people are so afraid that they won't be able to find value. If they can't evaluate, how can I find value? We don't need to find value. God is all value everywhere, always. We can never be without all value. It's impossible. So the idea of seeking value in reality is totally absurd, unthinkably absurd. I mean, if you have all value everywhere, always, how could you ever even consider seeking value, right? Evaluating. There's nothing to evaluate. That's why Jesus says God doesn't judge at all. There's nothing to judge, nothing to evaluate. God knows he gave all value everywhere, always. What was that? Oh, it's a moth. Okay. All value everywhere, always. And that's it. He doesn't evaluate. I don't know what that was. I thought it was a spider hanging there. It was a nice, beautiful moth looking for the light here. Okay. It's that simple. But then we say, wait a minute, that's too simple. I need to evaluate. And so then you lose sight of this practice because your mind says, I need to read some books. I need words. I need massive amounts of teaching so I can pour through those books and say, okay, what has value here and what doesn't have value? Let me sort through all these words and stuff. But what a great feeling it is to realize you don't have to do that, right? You don't have to do that at all. You don't even have to sort through all the spiritual practices at all. There's nothing you really, really need to sort through. Just wow. One evaluation for everything that arises. I hope I'm going to be enlightened today. Wow. I really fear that I might not be enlightened today. Wow. Now, you could find innumerable variations of practicing. It's so easy. You just try it. Just do it. There's very little to say about it. Just try it and do it. rare is it that anyone will even try this, because the habit of evaluation tells, oh, no, that there's nothing there. There's nothing. That's too simple. Nothing to evaluate. I got to do it some other way. And that other way gets nowhere because you don't flatten, you don't get familiar with flattening evaluation, which is necessary before you experience nothing to evaluate at all. So this is why everyone keeps failing and settling for some sort of niche in spirituality, some sort of niche, whatever it may be. You can throw all sorts of titles you want onto it, and you can use all sorts of robes and crowns and jewelry and thrones and flowers and all that stuff. It's a niche in spirituality. It can be, right? It can be. You can also have flowers if you want to. That's okay. But most settle for some niche, maybe an exalted niche in spirituality. You can dress a corpse up in clothes, or you can dress a living person up in clothes. Being dressed up in clothes doesn't of itself denote anything in particular, right? I'm just saying that we can always dress up a niche, okay, of spirituality, right? Just be aware of that. So the vast, almost, you know, just almost everyone, we keep settling for a niche of spirituality. We keep settling for that. And we feel like, oh, yeah, I feel more comfortable with that. So we think it must be right. Well, that comfort means we're just in a comfort zone of expectation of evaluation. We say, well, at least I got something to evaluate here. I can still evaluate. You say, oh, yeah, I feel more comfortable. It must be right. But once we keep doing this wow practice, we get less and less concerned about finding any niche in spirituality at all. And we find ourselves just motoring past all the niches of spirituality. And you just look at it and say, oh, I'm not interested in that. And that's kind of a little bit shocking, because all the luminaries of this world, the spiritual luminaries, most of them, not all of them, but a lot of them, you will just see like, oh, okay, I'm not really interested in that. It's a niche. That's not really what I'm after. Wow. Right? Wow. Okay. And it's just wow. Okay, that's a spirituality niche. Wow. Just keep wowing everything. Your reaction, just wow. And, you know, the positive, negative, good, bad, make sure you go between those two and accent both of those, like really positive and really negative, and just wow. And then also the wow, the stuff in between. And make sure you don't leave anything out. You don't make an exception. You don't make an exception and say, oh, well, that's really good. No. You say, oh, that's really good. Wow. Is my reaction to that. My evaluation of the really good is wow. My evaluation of the really bad is wow. You see? And so, yeah, the best person in the world is like this. My evaluation of the very best person in the world is wow. My evaluation of the very worst person in the world is wow. Okay? You want to use an example? Sri Sri Anandamayi. Say, my evaluation of Sri Sri Anandamayi is wow. And then use Hitler, for instance. My evaluation of Adolf Hitler is wow. Exact same evaluation. You see, most people would say it's blasphemous. The ego says, you can't do that. We just did. So try to take like the most positive and then the most negative and use just one evaluation to flatten that. Say, God is great. Wow. The devil is terrible. Wow. Same evaluation. So, Of course, the ego won't stand for that. The ego says, you can't do that. But it's just self-evaluation, this ego, it's all it is. And it's just familiarity's only problem. So the only reason I can do this is familiarity. That's it. Not because I'm smart, but because I'm familiar. So familiarity, it wins. It's decisive, not smartness, not at all. As long as smartness and intellect is driving, doing the driving, you're not going to succeed. You're not doing it right. You just practice, soulfully practice, genuinely practice. I got to do this. I don't have a choice. This is what works. This is what works. I know this will work, and then just do it. But the ego says, well, wait a minute, but what kind of niche am I going to get here? No niche. No niche, wow. I'm going to get a niche, wow. No niche, wow. You say, I love God, wow. I hate God, wow. You see that? There's no sacred cows in this practice. In fact, this is very important. You realize there's not a single sacred cow at all in this wow practice. All the entire vast ocean of evaluation, we must get familiar with viewing it just wow for everything. The entire spectrum, the 360-degree spectrum, in every which way, is just one evaluation, which is wow. And just get familiar with that. And this is literally the one insight that settles it all. This will at some point just be seen in its totality as a fact. And all regrets vanish. All regrets vanish. So just being able to actually teach this here now to the world like this is a revolutionary situation, actually. But as great as all this is, and it is great, I had something even more exciting happen today. It had to do with toothpaste. Yeah, it had to do with toothpaste. I'm just thrilled what happened today. Because God gave me some guidance today. I said, God, what do I do? Just give me, I asked Longchamp, I said, Longchamp, give me some guidance. You got 10 seconds. You know, you're in charge. And right away, there's this card that said, I saw it, it said, Sin Turf. Something like that. Sin Lawn. S-Y-N Lawn means synthetic lawn. And it was a card that belonged to the company that, you know, produces and installs synthetic lawn. Right away, I said, that's got to be it. What does that mean? Sin lawn. I said, well, it means synthetic lawn. And I says, hey, wait a minute. I have some synthetic lawn. I use that to practice a golf swing on. And then right away I realized that's what Longchamp wants me to focus on today. Because I was thinking of going to the driving range. And what he was telling me, he said, no. Don't go to the driving range. Just go to your synthetic grass where you swing your golf club with no ball there. It's just I have a rubber tee poking up through the synthetic grass, and then I practice hitting that rubber tee with the golf club. And he said, I want you to do that. So I got it right away. I said, okay, you got it. That's what I'm going to do. I will do that. And yesterday I realized that the next step in my golf is to hit the ball on the sweet spot. And so I said, how do I determine if I'm doing that or not with just a rubber tee? And I said, and I had this foot powder, a spray foot powder, Dr. Scholl's foot powder or something. And I sprayed it on the back of the tee right where the club's going to hit the tee, and it leaves this white residue of powder. And then I swang the golf club and it hits the tee, and it left kind of a mark on the club, but it wasn't, you know, super accurate. I said, well, this is something. And it told me something. I'm not doing it right. I'm hitting it too close to the heel. But then I said, you know, there's got to be a better way that gets it much more exact than that. If you're hitting a golf ball, you can put this tape across the club face that hits the ball and leaves little dimples on the tape, and you can tell where it hit. But I'm not hitting a ball, so that doesn't work. So then I went and got some whiteout corrective fluid, you know, the whiteout stuff. And so I paint a little dot there on the back of the tee, but I hit it, and that seemed to work a little bit, but it dries so fast that it, like, would stick to my club. I'd have a hard time getting it off of there, and often dried too fast on the tee, so it wouldn't transfer to the club face. So I said, this is not going to work. So I got some chalk and tried to put chalk. That didn't work. So that I said, the Holy Spirit said, why don't you go inside, go to the bathroom. That's usually where the best ideas come, right? On the toilet, right? That's where our greatest thinking is done, basically. Because everything stops for a while, right? Our mind stops. So I've been there in the bathroom, and suddenly it came to me. It says, why don't you use toothpaste? Toothpaste. I said, my God, that's a great idea. I wonder if that'll work. So I have this ultra-bright Sensodyne toothpaste. So I brought this tube out, and I squeezed the tube, and I put a dab of toothpaste on the very back of the rubber tee, right at the top there, simulating that that's where I want to hit the ball. That's where the ball is going to be, basically. And I tried it, and son of a gun, it worked. And I tried again, and it worked beautifully. It worked beautifully. The toothpaste is transferred right to the spot where the club hits it, and just sticks beautifully in a little spot right on the club face. And I can tell exactly where that club face is when it hits that tee. With toothpaste. I've never heard anything like that. It was just a brilliant, brilliant Holy Spirit, grace-filled innovation right there to help me out. And, I mean, a tube of toothpaste will last you like thousands of hits. You just need a tiny little dab. I said, wow, what a great progress this is. So, and then I found out that I'm not hitting it in the sweet spot at all. I said, uh-oh. But at least now I know exactly where I'm hitting it. And so I began adjusting my approach. And I finally found an approach that worked, because I found that the centrifugal force of swinging the club really hard pulls the whole body out towards the ball. And I wasn't accounting for that. That's why I kept hitting it on the heel. So I backed away from the tee, so the club head seemed to be a little far away from it, and then used that. And as I swing out towards it, and I began hitting it right in the middle of the club face, right in the middle, at least vertically. And again and again and again and again and again, and I got it dialed in really, really well. I said, oh my gosh, 44 years of playing golf, and I've never been able to look at this properly and find out what I was doing wrong. This whole time, I was doing something wrong, and I was hitting it too far on the heel, off center, and I was losing distance. 44 years of that, making a mistake like that. Because everyone says, well, line up the crown of the club face with the back of the ball, and that's what you're supposed to do. That's wrong. That's all wrong. That's all wrong. Because when you put that really strong swing on, just the very act of that swing, it tends to pull your arms, everything out away from the body, out away from the body. And so you need to start with farther back away from the ball in order to hit it in the center. Didn't know that. Nobody's ever said anything like that. And all my studying, 44 years of studying golf, playing golf, etc., nobody's ever said anything like that. It's amazing how poor golf instruction is. There's a million golf instructors, and I think it's very poor the way they teach. This innovative grip that I have is so much better than the normal grip, and they've never ever taught that. This technique here is fabulous. They've never taught that. It's quite extraordinary. The toothpaste technique, and having your club farther away from the ball because of the centrifugal force, whatever you call it, centrifugal force. So I have this knowledge now, and so do you. Apex, if you're an Apex yogin, are considering it, you get better insight, better knowledge. This is really amazing for me. And so I'm saying hallelujah, because this just transforms. It's transformative. I say, I now have a pretty good idea of how to center the ball up on the sweet spot and repeat it over and over and over again. Plus, I already have a very, very good swing, powerful swing, really fast, great bounce. I really go into it. I say, if I combine that with hitting it right on the sweet spot, You know, results are going to speak for themselves. So this keeps opening the door up to some sort of situation of incentive for other people, incentivizing others in some way towards apex yoga. And it's really weird. The way I look at my mind about golf now, imagining I'm playing golf, is completely different. It's like almost boring. Like, it's not much of a challenge anymore. The whole idea, feel of a golf course, I'm thinking about, it's all different now. It's so different. It's like, there's really no real challenge there. Kind of feeling, not much of a challenge at all there. It's not that interesting anymore. It's like, wow. Because when I was younger, it's like, I dream about it, I start getting all anxious, like, oh my God, what a huge challenge, this is going to be unbelievably difficult, I'm going to be hacking my way through the jungle, you know, this is such a great adventure, and now I'm just feeling like, I'm not hardly even interested at all. What's the trouble? There's no trouble. And the whole golf course seems short, so it's too short for me, you know. If I'm hitting it 280 off the tee, 380 yard hole is only 100 yards in. It's just a pitching wedge. I mean, that hit the drive pitching wedge. That's no trouble at all. You know, it's like, it's all become like smallish and childish to me now. Just so it's amazing how when your skill level rises, how your perception of the world changes. Well, the same thing with spiritual practice. Is this wow practice, dialing it in? It's like all it's easy. I mean, all this spirituality and stuff. It's like. Ah, okay. One moment, please. One moment. Uh-huh. Okay.
Yeah. All right. Yep. It's all good? Okay. Yeah. Well, you just drive safe, okay? All right. Okay, bye. Love you, bye.
The wow practice, it just changes your whole idea of spirituality and difficulty, and you just say, is that difficult at all? What the heck's going on? You just feel completely different towards the world, towards everything. It's easy. What's the big deal? It's easy. That's the attitude I have now. But I try not to think about the old golf course I used to go to where all the scars were. I just don't think about it anymore. I was thinking about teeing off in the first hole. I said, no. Forget that one. We're going to a different course. So, yeah, I don't like go back to the spiritual teachings I've had before, like A Course in Miracles, for instance. I struggled for, 15 years. The Journey Beyond Words, I've been with it for 23 years. And of course, A Miracle is along with that, so it's been almost 40 years. It was brutal. It was difficult. I struggle. So I don't go back. I don't go back to it so much now at this point because I know it really is this simple. All you have to do is flatten your evaluation and get familiar with just completely flattened evaluation, which is just like hardly no evaluation at all. Just wow to everything, and that's all you need to do. That's all you need to do, and then the peace of God will dawn upon your mind. Dawn upon you, and there's nothing to evaluate, and you say, that's fine, I'm comfortable with that, and it'll just stay with you because you're comfortable with it. You'll get more and more comfortable with it, and that's all there is to it. There's nothing more to it than that. So I try not to try to say, okay, now I've got it, maybe I can understand A Course in Miracles. No, don't do that. Just like in golf, I said, wow, I can just sweet spot it now with a great swing. And I said, I can go back and play that old course used to torment me. No. There are too many scars. I want to go to a different golf course, God. Okay, I'm not going back to the other golf course. I decide I'm not going back there. I'm not going back in triumph saying, now I've got it. No. Because it's easy to be pulled back into the old habits. You know, there's so many bad memories there of struggling that could easily transfer back into me and I could go back into struggling again. So I want a fresh start on a new golf course with a new swing, a superior understanding of everything, so that I have good memories, and say, wow, this is easy, this is great. So I'm not going to teach A Course in Miracles, okay? I don't teach A Course in Miracles. I don't even teach Journey Beyond Words. I teach just the WOW practice. That's it. That's all I teach, is the WOW practice. If you call it teaching, sharing, encouraging, you know, like that. I'm not going to go back and put it into its context of spirituality. Let's put it that way. Spirituality is what I've struggled with, what we all struggle with. I'm not going to do it. It's like an old golf course that you thought was wonderful and beautiful, and it was, but it was too tough, wasn't it? It beat the heck out of you. It beat you up. Like that, the golf course you used to play at, it was gorgeous and beautiful. I loved it, but it just beat me up. It beat everyone up. It beat everyone up. If it's just, it's too tough. It's just too punitive and difficult. So I'm not going, that's like spirituality, just beat me up. It beats everybody up. Spirituality beats everybody up, including you, right? So we're not going back to that. I'm not going back to spirituality. I'm done with it. I am done with spirituality. This WOW practice is just, that's it. So I'll just do the WOW practice and play golf and showcase that for people to really, they realize, hey, you know, here's someone who is just right on the WOW practice, and inevitably the fruits of this practice will arrive, right? Will drop, the fruit will drop. It's ripe, it's ripening the fruit, it will drop. And all they're doing is just playing golf. Yeah. No spirituality. No spirituality. At all. I mean, I'm wearing, you know, a golf shirt. Jordan Spieth's golf shirt. I'm not wearing, you know, all the spiritual garb, am I? And I don't believe you'll see me wearing spiritual garb. I'm really not into it anymore. Really, I'm just not. Speaking of spiritual garb, here's some right here. What is this? It is a rosary. It's a gigantic rosary. It's a gigantic rosary. It's a frightfully gigantic rosary. What is this? It's stuck here or something? Yeah, okay, so I don't know. How do we figure this out? Anyway, here's the crucifix. That's the... What the heck? I don't know what to say about this. Anyway, it's kind of... Oh, there we go. Okay, now we got it. We have Jesus on this crucifix, on this rosary that's kind of stuck on itself. And it would come off of there. Okay, finally it's unstuck. Got it. Got unstuck from the rosary. The rosary. Yes. Hey. Hey, 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 hey. So it's all these massive beads. So you do the rosary by counting beads, and these are huge beads, biggest ones I've ever seen. And there's different, four different carvings on each one of these beads. There's like, there's Sacred Heart of Jesus. There's Mama Mary with the infant child, Jesus child. And then there's, looks like Joseph with Jesus, and then Virgin Mary in her classic, that's a Guadalupe, actually, it's the Guadalupe pose right there. So this is probably from Hispanic rosary, and the centerpiece, of course, is Jesus' death, okay. You can see that, right, it's crucified, Jesus crucified. Okay, now, I just found this today, and God wanted me to find it, and I said, what the heck, God? He wanted me to talk, do a little talk here on this. Was in church last Sunday, Catholic church. The priest said something which was just mind-blowing, and it all clicked for me. It was so helpful. See, always keep an open mind to anything. Grace comes from any direction and every direction, actually. See, God is all value everywhere, always. Don't shut your mind to the grace. Think it has to come this way, or it has to come there. It can come anyway. And I'm, you know, a speck of dust could trigger like this great insight. If really anything can trigger it, if you're really, really aware and really willing. So, you know, we're listening to the priest homily. He says, gets up there. He says, well, you know, we're going to be baptizing. There's some candidates here. We're leading them towards baptism. And he says, how many of you know what baptism really stands for, the symbology of it in the church. How many of you know? And everybody's quiet. Uh-huh. He says, do you know? Anyone you know? And he says it's actually something you're kind of scared of. It's a terrible word, but it really, and so everyone's really quiet. And then I said, out loud but just quietly, I said, it's death. Baptism means death. I said, my gosh. And then the priest says, okay. And he talked a little bit, and they said, okay, well, baptism actually is consecration to death. It means death. And so he said, when we baptize you, so the baby's born, and after like a couple weeks or whatever, a month, it then dies, because we put it in the baptismal water, which signifies death. We've consecrated the baby to death, so it follows Jesus to the cross in death. And I was pretty stunned by this. But it all clicked together, and I understood exactly what's going on. Wow. Now, for me, I'm not baptized. I was never baptized because I'm not consecrated to death, actually. Death is our ultimate hope that we can fixate hallucination, fixate the mind, fixate freedom. And the way the Catholic Church deals with our insecurity about hallucinating is to say that death can fixate the mind. That Jesus' death proved that death can fixate the mind, and if you accept death the way that Jesus asked you to accept it, that you don't have to worry, your mind will be fixated too, but after you die. So what it really does is gives us the sense of sort of security during our days here in this world. Like that you think, well, I don't need to worry about the mind dropping hallucination, because there's some way to, I have faith that there's some way to fixate the mind. Jesus showed me there's some way to fixate the mind. So it acts like a drug to sort of drug us, drug our insecurities. It's a way to try to push them away. And so it seems to give a little meager, tiny bit crumb of hope to us. Like, I hope there's some way I can get rid of these insecurities. And if I just have enough faith, maybe I won't feel them so bad. So the whole purpose, you start out in Catholicism, is you're consecrated to death. They're saying death is the way. There is a way to fixate the mind. That's the great hope that we have, isn't it? So of course, when you tell everyone, we're all struggling so desperately here, I got to fixate the mind, I got to find some way to do it. And the Catholic Church says, well, we know how to do that. Jesus showed us that it's possible. In fact, God even sent Jesus into the world to die. In other words, God even gave the way to fixate the mind. And then you're consecrated to this, baptized in this, you think you got some security. It's like a security blanket. But I found it very interesting that I was never baptized. Because for me, to be an apex yogin, you have to give up death. You have to just set death aside. You said death isn't the answer. And refuse to use death in any way for any answer. It's off the plate. Totally. And that's what I did when I've always been that way, but in 1978, I made that decision very, very consciously. I realized I will never use death as the answer for anything. Okay? As the answer for anything at all. And that's the only way you can ultimately become an apex yogin. Without that, you're not going to make it. You have to say death is absolutely off the plate, because that's our great hope. Death is our great hope, that fixates the mind, because what happened is we identify the mind with the brain, okay, and the body, and that when the body stops moving, we equate that with the brain has stopped working, right? The brain has stopped working. It's frozen. It stopped working. It's fixated. And so we then equate that and think the mind has been fixated. We found the way to fixate the mind. So death is just our pretending. It's all imaginary, all this appearancing. It's just light pretending that mind can't be fixated. That's why death keeps taking place. Seems to take place. That's we're the ones who are pretending to die in order to fixate the mind, and it's our great hope. And then we use decay to make sure that the body doesn't come back to life. The brain doesn't start working again. So you got to have decay set in, rotten decay and collapse of the body, right? It's got to. Otherwise, the brain might start working. The body will get up, and say, "Hey, everybody!" Kind of like Lazarus, right? Because that was the example they're talking about in church. It's Lazarus. Jesus said, "Lazarus, come out of the grave. Come on." And he's been in there for 4 days. And they said, "No, Jesus, he's all rotting and stinking. Don't roll the stone away. It'll be horrible." And out of the grave. Walk Lazarus, say, "Hey, everybody," all in his burial clothes. Jesus basically said, "Hey, Lazarus, stop pretending to be dead. Come on. Who are you fooling? You're not fooling me one bit. You know that." Lazarus said, "Yes, Lord, you're right. Sorry. I was on my smartphone, Lord. I forgot. I was doing some death app, Lord, and I kind of forgot that it was all pretense. So thanks for reminding me." That's basically all it is. So, there you have it. That's the placebo security blanket thing of religion in general, but Catholicism is very explicit about this. Hey, we really can help you overcome your insecurities. It's not fear of death that we're frightened of. We're afraid of life. Okay, so everybody's saying, you know, and so if anyone, a religion like Catholicism, consecrates us through baptism to death, we're saying, "Oh, thank you." We say, "Oh, thank you so much. I feel so much better now because I'm, my God, I'm so glad that I for sure I'm going to die." It's a religion of death. That's all it is. It's a religion of death. And it reassures us that we're going to die. And then we say, "Okay, I don't have to worry about life. That's great. I don't have to worry about no evaluation. Nothing to evaluate. Ah, oh, thank you so much, Mama Mary. You know, I say the rosary. Come, you know, whatever it says, in an hour of death. You know, pray for us in an hour of death." But it's all about death, the rosary, isn't it? Really, like just assuring ourselves that, yeah, we're going to die. We're going to die. Pray for us in an hour of death means I'm dying. Thank you. Because save me from no evaluation of reality, of true life. So it saves us from true life. We think, and they say, "Don't worry." Then you get to heaven, and you never come. You know, that's good, and you're permanently saved from it. And then you find yourself reincarnated. And like for me, I remembered all my past lives, and I said, "Oops, doesn't work, does it? Son of a gun. Uh-oh. I can't save myself from life. It's impossible." And then I realized I have to consecrate myself to life. And I got a problem here because I have this nasty habit of evaluation. And every time I try to get it consecrated to life, I start trying to evaluate it again and I lose it. So I said, "Holy cow, this is troublesome." And the Holy Spirit said, "Don't worry, you'll do it." Okay, it's like that. 1 second, please. Yeah. But it's going to take a while. Okay, the Holy Spirit was very honest, of course. He said, "Look, we'll get it. It'll take a while. You got to work at it. Familiarity takes a while. It's not an intellectual. You can't solve it intellectually," the Holy Spirit said. "It's only solved by through familiarity. Because intellectualism is just another evaluation. You're just evaluating. Oh, I get it. I get it. I don't need to evaluate reality. Okay, my evaluation is now that I get it. That's an evaluation. We have to literally become familiar with no evaluation. And we do that by first just one evaluation for everything. It's the only practice we need to do. And we can wear golf clothes doing this practice, or we can wear a suit and tie doing this practice. We can wear loungewear, pajamas, shorts and t-shirts. I mean, you know, you can wear any kind of clothes you want, and you can sit on any type of seat or bench you want, or lie down. It doesn't matter. You can be barefoot or wearing shoes or sandals or whatever. Just do the practice. And you can do it anywhere at all. I do it all the time, and no matter what I'm doing. It just occurs to me, hey, do the practice, start practicing. And I start getting into it, and I get, you know, really starts flowing, and it's like, great. But just like warming up a golf swing, you got to warm up a little bit, swing the club a few times, and then you start swinging, and you get better and better. You get more warmed up and loosened up. And you say, okay, I'm really sailing along here. That's great. And then you start sweet spotting it, which means you really start digging into some resistance you feel within you. You've got to search, keep searching for that resistance, keep doing stuff, and it'll come up. And you say, wow, I don't know if I want to say wow to that. You know, I think that's a valuable, that's got value for me. And it certainly has more value than this other thing. And say, no, one value, wow to that and wow to that. And juxtapose various concepts, positive and negative, and so you feel uncomfortable about it. And then that's really, you're really hitting the sweet spot of your practice that way. Simple, right? Yeah, that's what the ego fears. That's what we fear. Simplicity. Oh, no, you're getting too close to life. Hey, I got to go die, you know, and then rot. And so 99.9999999% of us continue to pursue death and decay rather than just do the simple practice. That's it. What more is there to say? It's an absolute fact. And I'm not going to name the priest's name, but he did all of us a great favor, you know. It's funny. Again, I get help from everyone. So I try not to evaluate anyone because I just look for the grace that's coming through them, you know, to me. Even the whores, you know, that on Facebook, right, that try to hook you in the scam, the scammers of I need money, I need to deposit this money in your account and then get it out of your account. So give me your, you know, bank account number because I have a lot of money, but it's frozen somewhere. Blah, you know, all this, the Nigerian scammer thing, and that's on Facebook, various ways. And there's so many scams on Facebook, actually. But even those, I try to say, okay, what is the grace that's helping me? And if you're open to it, it's there. You see it. You say, oh my gosh, how helpful that is. That's tremendously helpful. I love that. Thank you. So, what it is. Is everybody is helping me out because, again, I said the world set me free. In one of these rare cases where the world had enough faith in me that everyone set me free. They decided, they made a vote, and they made a decision. They made a collective decision. You can go free. Why do they do that? Because they trust in the Dharma Kings. The Dharma Kings have given enough faith to this world where there's some trust in the world now in the Dharma Kings. This is why we're so blessed here in this world. They only let me go because they knew I was a friend of the Dharma Kings. That's why I was really let go. And they knew they could at least ask me to go ask the Dharma Kings to give me some teaching to bring back to them. Now, they didn't know if I would do it or not, but they said, you know, he might. It's worth the risk. There's a risk on their part. And they set me free. It was a risky thing. Because I might just say, to heck with it, you know, I'm not going to come back. But they said, please, 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 please go ask the Dharma Kings for help. We need help. So if it weren't for the Dharma Kings, they wouldn't have released me. The world, all of you would not have released me. So we have the Dharma Kings to thank. That's why I always speak of the Dharma Kings as essential, essential. I'm in the service of the Dharma Kings because they're the ones who have brought forth this goodwill into the world, enough spiritual goodwill, where the world is willing to take a risk on some of us who are really far along, that they know that we have the capacity to go visit the Dharma Kings. And they told me, they said, we know you're very close to the Dharma Kings, and we know that they'll listen to you. We know you can go see them, so go do that for us. And they had more faith than me. I said, I don't know if I'm that close, you know. They said, no, yes, you are. And they said, you might even be a king yourself. And I said, no. And they said, well, you go and talk to them then. And so I said, well, okay, I'll try, I'll see what they say. So again, they have built up so much goodwill, enough goodwill, so the whole world is willing to take a risk like that and set some of us free. And like in my case, they set me free. It's extraordinary, very rare. Because it wasn't me, you know. I mean, I told them about the Dharma Kings. I explained, and they believed me. They said, "Yeah, I believe you're right." You know, so the impact of these Dharma Kings has been enormous, and we're starting to see. I'm an example of that. The work that they've done. You can start with Manjushri, which is the whole Buddhist sort of Buddhist thing, and then Padmasambhava, which is the Vajrayana Buddhist thing, Tibetan Buddhist thing, at least Vajrayana, and then you can bring in Longchenpa, who's like the apex of Buddhism, really. He's the apex of all Buddhism, really. And then you get Jamyang Kenshi Choki Lodro, who's this great ecumenical, titanic King Trisen Detsen, who really is one of the greatest figures in history as far as spreading the Dharma King's teaching. And then you get Jesus Christ, of course, who has done, you know, immeasurable amount of building good a faith in the Dharma Kings in truth. And then you have Ram Maharshi, who's done a tremendous, especially in modern times, his influence is all pervasive in the world. And then you have Sri Sri Anandamaya Ma, who permeated every aspect of our world here, our culture, our world, our activities. She permeated every aspect, and that has caused this overall global consciousness of some trust in liberation, some trust. So you put all of those Dharma Kings together and everything they have done, plus some other ones throughout history too, okay. And goodwill, there's a little bit of trust within us now. There's some trust, enough for the whole global, for global consciousness to trust in me to say, you're free of this world. We're letting you free. You can go. So that's an extraordinary testimony I have here about all of you, this whole consciousness here, not only here, but probably in a wider arc too, that shows you have some faith. You have some faith. You really do. So start accepting this. You know what? The very fact that Clary Ross was set him free, that means I have faith in the Dharma Kings. I have some faith in the Dharma Kings. Everybody does here. It was a collective decision. Like they weighed the scales, and finally the weight of the scale was such they said, okay, that means you can go free. So everybody had something to do with that. Everyone. So what I'm finding is all these different people who really are just enmeshed in spirituality, the hell of spirituality, are friending me on Facebook, and I'm saying, I know exactly what their trouble is. I've seen that before. Oh boy, that's trouble, you know. It's all troublesome spirituality, all of it. There's that, I see that niche, okay, the niche, this niche, they're all niches. But they all have something to give, to help me out with. They give me something I gotta make sure I don't block anybody so quickly. I mean, you know, you get the message, and then if they're really problematic, you know, okay, fine. But if their niche is problematic, but maybe I'm just gonna try not to block. I don't know. It's a tough one because some can be problematic to me. You know, it's like I don't really want to deal with that. But they're offering something to me. You know, they're coming to me with something. Now, I don't want some woman coming to me and offering her body to me, you know. That's not the offering I'm looking for, okay? But I have to look, you know, maybe there's something else that, you know, that they're doing, okay? They're putting some faith, you're saying, okay, you know. So it's a little gift, a little gift. There's somebody trying to offer me something. I should just say, well, thanks, but you know, maybe later. You're not, like I say, thanks, but you're not my body. I don't care, something, or, you know. Not, you know, try to be a little nicer to everybody. Because they're offering me something they think is of value to me. You know? But, of course, I'm telling, look, only the wow practice has value in this world. Really, just do that practice. Only flattening evaluation has value. That's the only really value we can speak of, because it frees us from all value. All evaluation. It frees us from all flattening evaluation, frees us from all evaluation, and getting familiar with that enables us to experience and abide in the peace of God, which is all value everywhere, always, which is God. So I guess I'll just say, hey, God, okay. And so, yeah, people, but people from all different, I get approached by, you know, you think that I'm approached just by high spiritual people or something. No. I get approached by some of the lowest type of people imaginable. And it's always been that way. And they want to, because they had some role too in setting me free. Everyone has. And so I just accept, okay, thank you. So I thank everyone here. I give thanks to everyone here, but the thanks really goes to the Dharma Kings, doesn't it? It starts and ends there. Because without them, none of you would have had the faith to set me free. They're responsible for that. They're responsible. The great traditions and the Dharma Kings that helped pioneer those traditions through people having us having faith in them. They're responsible for the faith that we have here. Now, we don't have total faith, so we made some pretty weird judgments, evaluations of them, and found some pretty weird niches of spirituality to try and reflect, you know, some pretty weird mirrors reflecting them. We all have these mirrors reflecting the Dharma Kings, and some of them are, you know, like, well, that's a pretty weird mirror you've got there. It's okay, but that's hope and fear. It's a that's an unusual mixture of hope and fear there. You know, it's an evaluation. And wow. But really, the destitute come to me. You know, the poor in spirit, the destitute, those so stuck in a terrible niche, they tend to show up to me. You know, it's like, have pity on me. It's like, look how. You know, it's like Mary Magdalene going to Jesus, say like, you know, wow, I'm just such a, I have such this hideousness. She was hideous, Mary Magdalene, wasn't she? She was really hideous. But she said, I got faith in you, Jesus. You know, I really do. And you know, I believe you can help me. You know, I believe you can help me. But wow, was she was just like the worst woman, you know, you ever want to come across, Mary Magdalene. So I get some Mary Magdalenes coming to me, you know. It's like, wow, it's not easy, you know. And she know, but Mary Magdalene realized, man, I am a sinner. I mean, I am a horrible sinner. I mean, meaning, I am just stuck in a horrible niche here of spirituality, trying to convince, you know, men that. There's some way to be distracted from their, you know, insecurity of hallucination. And then I'm it, you know, and I just hate it. I just hate it. And I just feel that Jesus, you've got the answer for me. I don't know what the answer is, but I just feel you have the answer. So people come to me, they don't know what the answer is, but they have a feeling like, you know, I got a feeling you know the answer. And they just have a sort of a gut feeling, you know. So I apologize to anyone that I've blocked, you know. Some stuff is just so, you know, I don't know. But I've got to look at that. I've got to look at it more carefully here. Because it may be Mary Magdalene coming to me and saying, you know, I just got a feeling you know the answer. And I need the answer because I'm a wicked, wicked woman. You know, I'm just terrible. I'm notorious. I'm notoriously terrible. And I know it. But I don't know what to do about it. But I got a feeling that you do know. So, you know, I'm gonna quit. You know, she's the quintessential example, Mary Magdalene, of what we're talking about here is someone who's really messed up, so badly messed up, but they have faith in the Dharma Kings, changed their life around. And she just said, you know what? I'm done with that. I am done with that. I'm done with that. Go and sin no more, Jesus said. Go and sin no more. Drop the spirituality thing. Stop trying to stabilize hallucination. Stop thinking you have a way to stabilize hallucination. You don't. And you never will. So we have to drop hallucination. And the only way to do that is to flatten out evaluation so you're familiar with that. And then you can drop hallucination. And then you will see what's hallucination? We're hallucinating the absence of God. So meaning we're hallucinating the absence of all value everywhere always. We're pretending not to see it. So when we drop hallucination, we'll experience all value everywhere always. The peace of God will be upon our minds, and there's nothing to evaluate. It's that simple. It's really that simple. It's so simple. So, I mean, it's not easy for me because I keep thinking that it's really some really exalted spiritual people will friend me and you know stuff. Some do, but not many. Some have. If there's a few, especially if you're doing the WOW practice, you're very exalted. Only the ones who are very, very advanced are able to do the WOW practice. So if any of you are actually doing the WOW practice, you got to be sure that you are super, super advanced. And so keep doing it. Keep doing it. But that does it. So most that you know reach out to me are really messed up. Really stuck in some weird trip. But, you know, haven't we all been stuck in a really weird trip? Yeah. Yeah, I have too, right? But you know, so I got to say, yeah, you're right. I do have the answer. So congratulations. You got something great in you, don't you? You have like capacity to tune in to spirit. So bring it on, everybody. I guess everybody, I just, you know, come on, 10 new Facebook requests every day. I'm just going to have to confirm them all. I'm just going to confirm them all. Not that their posts are relevant or anything, you know. I mean, I've gotten used to, I get 100 new posts every notifications every morning or more. I mean, all the Indians, they post like crazy, you know. Someone gives me like 30 posts every half an hour. I mean, this is ridiculous. But I'm able to scan down them all. I realize nobody's commented on anything I said. Nobody's liked anything I said. Okay, great. They just want to be reassured that they're my friend. I'm on their friends list, okay? Yeah, all right. But very, very few comment or interact with me in any way. It's amazing. But that's the way Facebook is, isn't it? You'd be surprised. You look at people, they say, well, I got 10,000 friends. And I look at all their posts, and like there's like one or two people liking or commenting, or like a couple likes and like one comment or no comments. And they got 10,000 friends. I say, holy cow, it's that way for everybody. Only very few actually get a lot of comments or likes. Very few. If you want a lot of comments and likes, just put up a picture of Sri Sri and Anamai Ma, and you'll get a lot of likes and a lot of comments, which are all Jai Ma, basically. Jai Ma. Jai Ma, Jai Ma, Jai Ma, Jai Ma. Yeah. Yeah. That's how you do it. But, you know, that's the formula for that. But I realize, hey, okay. I mean, how about putting up original, you know, here, WOW practice is it. One insight settles it all. Nobody's going to like that. Right? Pass it by. It's amazing. But it's so true. We have to laugh about it. We have to laugh at what's going on. Otherwise, we're going to freak out. You know, everyone's stuck in spirituality or a negative denial of spirituality. I mean, you know, atheism and stuff like that. One of the two. That's still evaluation. They're stuck. They say, well, we have a different way to evaluate. You know, science, mathematics, calculation. We're going to evaluate that way. And your spirituality evaluations are crazy. I hate that. They're both the exact same thing. Play of hope and fear. Different styles of the play of hope and fear. Just evaluating. They're both evaluating. That's all. So everyone here is stuck in evaluation, the habit of evaluation. And very few ever get, or in the short term, very few are going to get to the WOW practice. Ram Maharshi said, taking the long-term picture, great many will. And he said, you'll be very helpful to a great many in the long term. I don't know if he means in other lives or whatever. But short term, you know, it's just not happening very much. It's just not happening. And I understand why. It's so difficult to get to it because you doubt it. I say, wait a minute, I got to evaluate. And if you just give one evaluation to everything, that's not really evaluating. Well, it is. It's just giving one evaluation. But that gets us jittery, you know, that's too close to no evaluation. I want to have lots of evaluation, lots of spirituality, lots of books, lots of stuff to study. I've got a whole library. It's going to take me lifetimes to get through this library. I got to the point with the Course in Miracles in 1993 where I finally just gave my book away, my treasured book that was worn out. You know, I just spent my whole life, 15 years with it, just nonstop. You know, it's a treasure for me. I mean, I had no treasure in the world except A Course in Miracles, and I gave it away. I had three volumes. I gave them away to a used bookstore. I said, I have got to move on from all these words. I've got to go beyond words. I've got to go beyond words. I got to find a practice that's going to work for me, that's really it, you know. And so that was really extremely difficult to do. But it shows my commitment that I did it. I said, I can't have any books. I got rid of all my books. I had no books. I said, I have got to get away from books. This is killing me. This is just spirituality. I'll never succeed unless I just get away from books. So ultimately, about a year or so ago, I bought another Course in Miracles. And I don't really read it hardly at all. Just occasionally I'll look in it a little bit. And I bought another, I gave a Journey Beyond Words away too. Can you believe that? I gave that away. Huh, yeah, and I bought another one finally. I was without that for maybe 10 or 15 years. I gave that away. So I didn't have any books. And the book that I got to start getting books again was Spaciousness, the Radical Zogchen of the Vajra Heart by Longchenpa. That's how I found out who it was that came to me in the dream. And I said, wow, this book is really worth taking a look at. And that's how I kind of got introduced to Tibetan Buddhism. And I've been able to look at Tibetan Buddhism. And then again, like I say, I got to go beyond Tibetan Buddhism, all the words, all the tantra, all the practices and the words and stuff. I got to go beyond that too. So it's just the wow practice. It's all that we need. And Padmasambhava has helped me with that. He says, one insight settles it all. I trusted him, I believed it, and I experienced it. And I said, wow, you are right. That is so true. One insight settles it all. That's the real core. That's the real heart teaching. One insight settles it all. And I put my faith and trust in it. I really believed it, and I experienced it. And I said, oh my gosh, that is so amazing. All regrets vanish as if they never were. There's not even a trace of memory of any regret. That's how we will feel. Soon enough, as we do this practice, we will come upon this, and it's like nothing ever happened. Nothing ever happened. No evaluation ever took place. Because it really didn't, did it? We were just pretending to evaluate. Right? We were just pretending, actually. Ah, man, my back. Been swinging the golf club so much. But the swing is, it's getting grooved. I mean, I was putting the swing and the finish was just right. Everything was just right. I'll be able to put a little more power into it, but I was trying to hit the sweet spot, so I was really not trying to swing as hard as I could. But still swinging hard, and the follow-through really torques my body and turns it around, and I'm right on my toes and the edge of my feet. I'm putting so much effort into it. You need a very strong core to do swing that way. I really use my core to torque the body through. So, my core is good. My weight, I'm very slim. Slim and strong, lean and mean, which is what we need for right now. So, I mean, you know, it's just every day, morning, when I look for friends on Facebook, new friends, and it's like, oh my God, another one. Okay, what's this one going to be like? Oh God. I know it's coming. You're like, uh-oh. There it is, you know. Is it spirituality niche number one, number two, or number three? Ah, you get number three. Come on down. You get a date with number three. The dating game, you know, the Facebook game, the dating game, yeah. Ask questions. Is it? Okay, I choose number three. And here she is. You know, it's like, wow. Way. Smile, although your heart is breaking. So, everyone's bringing me a gift, saying, thank you, thank you, thank you, thank you for helping us out. I don't really quite understand how you're helping me out, helping everyone out, but you are. I know you are. So, okay, cool. It's great. Thank you for recognizing it. Okay, it's kind of cold out here. Worked all day today, and then swang a golf club, and got so tired, took a little nap, now I'm taping. But I don't know, swinging a golf club as hard as you can, like 50 times, that's kind of, you kind of get tired doing that. Because that's not normal. You don't do that in a round of golf. You only swing a driver like maybe 10 times. And that's over a 4.5 hour period. I'm swinging it 50 times, like in a half an hour or something. Whew, man, but I gotta back off of that. But I'm doing it. I had to do it just to try to dial in my swing. So it's like practice. You really push the practice. You can push the wow practice really intensely, and then you're going to be tired. You are. But you proved yourself you can do it, and you make tremendous progress this way. So, like, bursts of intensity with the wow practice are very helpful. I did it this morning, had a tremendous burst with it. And I just was like, oh, wow, I'm really, really digging. This is great, really great. And now, right now, I kind of took a little break from it, not as so intense. Kind of, you have to kind of let yourself settle down a little bit. It's like, wow. So the wow, one evaluation for everything, and then full stop in the wow is to realize, have the wow of your wow practice, saying, let me now stop it. So full stop in the wow is part of the wow practice. Wow practice is flattening all evaluation, and then in doing so, going past your expectations, you want to block panic from your success. So you then full stop in the wow, just wow, not even evaluating anything. It's just wow. That's it. Nothing else. And just let everything calm down and settle down. Recover from the effort. Oh, yeah. I was thinking of not eating today, but I started getting weak, and so I did eat. Had a nice, great, had a piece of Ezekiel sprouted grain bread with butter, and then sesame seed butter tahini on top of that, and then a whole banana, organic banana, which are very good, and then I put a whole bunch of honey, mixed a whole bunch of honey with the tahini, or organic honey. Local organic honey, and then put a banana on top of that, sliced up a banana, and put pieces on top of that stick. The honey sticks real nice, and then ate that. That was my breakfast, along with a smoothie of OJ and green drink, the green drink of all different mixed greens, and chocolate protein powder and blueberries. Frozen blueberries. That was my breakfast, the combination of those two. That's pretty good breakfast. It's a really good breakfast. And then had a few little snacks, and then a little Caesar salad. And so eating stuff. So eat stuff, You go ahead and eat a little bit of workout, and do the wow practice. You don't have to be some spiritual person, right? What in the world is this? Okay. Oh boy, it's baseball season. I'm getting texts. Yeah, sorry. 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 But I'm not watching baseball. Sorry. But hey, we can do the wow practice as we even use technology too, can't we? Yes, we can. Or at least try. I'm lousy at it. I don't even know how to text. There we go. Hardly. Okay. Yeah. Wow. Wow. My team lost yesterday. Wow. I hope my team wins tonight. Wow. I don't think my team's going to win tonight. Wow. I really believe my team's going to win tonight. Wow. I really think my team's going to lose tonight. Wow. Same wow. Same evaluation of winning and losing. Good and bad, winning and losing, hope and fear. Same evaluation. Now, I realize in this wow practice, I suddenly realize that's Longchenpa's practice, because he's the one, when I ask for help, to help the world. He's the one that arrived in my dream, and he arrived by walking across this vast ocean. I saw this figure walking across this vast ocean. He was walking on top of the water. And then he arrived, he walked right under the beach. I said, oh my God. I said, and then I tried to think of something to ask him. I said, how was the water? How was the ocean? Was it warm or cold? He said, oh, it was both. It was both. It was both. I said, huh. Well, he walking on water is the well practice. It means flattening all evaluations. Flattening so you don't sink into evaluating. The ocean is the ocean of hope and fear. It's really the ocean of evaluating. And so walking on water means you're not evaluating. So Jesus walking on water means Jesus was free of all evaluation. He had the Christ mind, which is all value everywhere always, is the Christ mind. So that was symbolized in the Bible as walking on water. Okay? So in the dream, Longchenpa walked on water as he came into this world to visit me and help me out and help me help the world out. And help him to help the world out also. So he walked across this vast ocean on the top of the water. So I had to ask him, like, I wanted to find out, who is this? This is amazing. That's the wow. The wow practice enables us to walk on water. Maybe not literally, but it really has a spiritual meaning, walking on water. It means you're not evaluating. You're free of evaluation. Okay, so this text helped me remember to tell you that, right? So the grace right here. Somebody gave us some grace right here. What did he have to say? He says, really, wow. The text says, really, wow. That's hilarious. So isn't that amazing? That someone sends a text with really, wow. The wow right there. Really, I really love the wow. That's fabulous grace right there. Fabulous grace. And how many texts have I sent? 44. It says right here, I've sent 44 texts. That's 44 right there. Yeah. Oh my God, that's wowish. Can you believe that? Synchronicity, right? Minds are one. Minds are one. So love everyone and thank everyone for the gifts that they give you. And for the help they give you, and for the spirit that they have in their memories. Because everybody in this world right now has some faith. Everybody has some faith. Even Mary Magdalene has some faith. There's a lot of Mary Magdalenes in the world right now. A lot. A lot. So many. World full of Mary Magdalenes, actually, right now. It's tough. I mean, if you're a guy, it's tough. You know, just being a man in this world is not easy. I'll tell you, you are the hunted, you know, the predator. There's so many female predators in this world right now, just billions, and they're hunting you. And I don't like to be hunted. You know, I really don't like it at all. And really, no men like to be hunted. They don't like it at all either. But, you know, this is how it is, you know, bummer. So I kind of try to stay away from all that. And you realize, I mean, you look in their eyes and they just realize, you know, they're hunting you to death, you know. They say, ah, here's somebody that I can help die. Great. And we'll distract ourselves. We can distract ourselves till death do us apart and avoid, you know, liberation. Together we can avoid liberation. It's like, no. don't hunt me, please. But, you know, they're gifts now, so that's great. Little gift. I have to be able to see it. I have to be able to discern it. Uh-oh. Oh, how techie. Yeah. I don't know what this is about. I'll just say wow. Okay. I just said wow. That's it. What else can I say? He said wow. I said wow. It's all good. Apex Yogan. What's Apex Yoga? Wow is Apex Yoga. Just wow. It's just wow. That's all. Somebody just wants somebody to talk to, you know. It's like, my God, my wife's driving me crazy. Can't I just talk baseball? Wow. Yeah, honey-do list. I mean, every guy I talk to, it's like older guys. Like, I talked to someone recently. I said, "You're retired? It's great." I said, "Are you kidding me?" He said, "I got a honey-do list that goes on forever." He says, "I'm a bit more busy now than I was when I was working." He says, "I don't even like it, to tell you the truth. It never ends. It's unbelievable." I mean, it's just, I thought I, you know, would have joy in retirement. I'm not really enjoying it that much as much as I thought I would. Yeah, guys keep working just to avoid the honey-do list, you know. Really. They hope that death will get them before the honey-do list will get them. Oh my gosh. I'm pretty resistant to that. I say, yeah, I'll get it, I'll get it, I'll get it sometimes. But then I don't get it. Eventually, maybe I do, but I say taping comes first, you know, all this comes first. And then, you know, if we get around to it, you know, maybe God will help me get around to it. And in some way or another, kind of resolves somehow. But I certainly tend to not get it, do that. You know, it's like, well, I don't know. I don't really need to do that. It's not really that important, is it? I've got some resistance, which is great. It's necessary. Otherwise, we'll just be slaves, 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 drone slaves, actually. Really, the older you get, the worse it becomes. Becomes horrible. Later on, you know, you gotta do everything. You gotta do everything, everything, everything. You gotta die. You're right? Come on, aren't you gonna die? No, actually. Well, let me help you. No, thanks. Okay. So, yeah, I did the WOW. I got WOW. I sent a WOW back. Apex Yoga. I'm an Apex WOW Yogin. So trend in that direction. This is all helping you trend in the right direction, which is better. You know, it's the best thing you can possibly do. If you can't do the WOW practice yet, trending in that direction is the best thing you can possibly do in the in, you know, with your life. The best thing you can possibly do with your life. So if you are trending that way, you really are on the right track. Congratulations. Now go play golf. Or whatever, you know, right? If you go dancing, go dancing. If you want to go dancing. Uh-oh. Gosh. Oh no, a monster has been created here. Oh my God. Yeah, okay. The Okay. Yep. Oh no. Baseball season. Oh no. Holy cow. I'm gonna have to shut my phone off. But I can't do that because I have to be on call. Okay, whatever. It's all good. I'm gonna go now check out Facebook and see how many irrelevant posts there are. Which all have something for me, right? It's, oh, okay. You can get grace from anything. Anything, 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 anything. Even a cat walking across the street. Oh, that cat. Oh, yeah. There's some animal that just climbed over the fence. I don't know. I heard that. Some animals are moving around. Okay. But, wow, everything. Okay. Just stay on it. If you can't do it, just stay with us. Just say, keep working towards it. It's not easy to get to this. It took taking me a lifetime to get to this. A lifetime of intense effort. And you think, well, I can't do that. Well, what else have you got to do? What else have you got to do, really? Because, you know, watch television, basically, right? I mean, no, don't do that. It's better just to sit, do nothing than watch television. It is. Just be bored instead of watching television. Don't distract yourself with frivolity and all that stuff. Just, And if you do something, just do it mildly, you know, and try to turn your interest away from it more and more and more and more and more. Or if you watch TV, just wow everything. Like, wow, this wow, this wow, this wow, this wow. Just flatten whatever you're doing. Flatten your evaluation of it. Flatten your evaluation of it. Flatten your evaluation of it. Okay? All right. Very great. Very, very great. And wow.